So welcome to the seminar on Understanding the Times, with a great big long subtitle here. It's a bit of a mouthful, a pre-modern meditation on the modernist roots of postmodernism. A pre-modern meditation on the modernist roots of postmodernism. Meditation because in this seminar we'll be looking at various cultural artistic expressions of different worldviews, different spiritualities, and having an opportunity to meditate upon those and to discuss them. And I'm kind of equally as interested in giving us a feeling of what it likes to sort of live within different worldviews and spiritualities, as much as I am to trace the ideological connections and differences between them. To trace those connections in a sort of history of ideas kind of way, because these different worldviews, spiritualities crop up over time, but they don't disappear when a new one crops up, so they then live alongside each other. And today, I would say we have these three different worldview spiritualities of a pre-modern, particularly in the West, pre-modern Christianity, of modernist, sort of secular humanist, materialist kind of worldview, and postmodernism of various degrees, as we'll see, living alongside one another. Let me draw your attention to this wonderful piece of art at the front here by the Japanese Christian artist Makoto Fujimura. And this is a piece of art called White Tree. And Fujimura uses traditional Eastern techniques of painting that uses very sort of expensive materials in the minerals and the sort of gold flecks and so on that go into his artwork, but uses that to express a Christian worldview. And of course, you know, what does white tree put you in mind of? Biblically speaking, we have trees at the beginning in the Garden of Eden, and we have the tree of life in Revelation at the end. A white tree, etc. So things are very subtly being said and communicated here. And we'll look at some of the ways in which philosophical ideas communicate through art, even when it's not particularly sort of programmatic. Well, this is not what you might immediately think of as a sort of traditional piece of Christian artwork. You know, it's not an icon, it's not a painting of the Virgin and Child, or Jesus on the cross, or what have you, which are obviously very explicitly about religious themes, at least. But a piece of art doesn't have to explicitly feature things that shout at you, I'm talking about Christianity, or I'm talking about atheism, in order to be imbued with and to communicate, therefore, something of a person's life and worldview. I'm not going to read this whole quote from Augustine, but this is St. Augustine from his great voluminous work, The City of God, where he talks about in his day that two cities have been formed by two different loves. The earthly, by the love of self, even to the contempt of God, and the heavenly, by the love of God, even to the contempt of self. And he saw this division between the city of the world and the city of God in sort of Pauline terms. The former glories in itself, the latter in the Lord, and so on. And he gives this wonderful description here. And today, I think this still holds true, but it's just that the city of the world is itself divided between modernism and postmodernism. Although, as we'll see, actually, that's not the radical divide that it at first appears. Actually, there's a continuity of underlying concepts between modernism and postmodernism. Nicholas Wolterstorff, the Christian philosopher from America, in his book Educating for Shalom, for peace, for wholeness, says this, that there's a dispute raging today between those who see the Enlightenment project of governing our existence by reason as an unfinished project promising liberation on which all should continue to work. And on the other hand, those who see in that Enlightenment project little but the tyranny of reason, with a capital R. The first party says that if we don't continue to govern our lives by reason, we can only expect more of the terrors of irrationalism. Think of the French Revolution here, you know, founded within the Enlightenment age, the French Revolution, founded on Enlightenment values. They installed a girl dressed up as the goddess Reason in the cathedral there and tried to secularize the state and so on. But the horrors of the French Revolution, the beheadings, the killings of priests and so on, the terrors of irrationalism that flow from an apparent dedication to reason. The second party says that if we don't continue to govern our lives by reasons, we can only expect more of those terrors. In brief, that is the dispute between the defenders of modernism and of postmodernism, and it's intense and it's confused, and I want to say a plague on both of your houses, as it were, because I'm neither a modernist nor a postmodernist. I am a pre-modernist. So two different cities, two different worldviews or spiritualities. A worldview is a dwelling place. It's your mental home. And it's like a mirror, to borrow an analogy from the postmodern philosopher Richard Rorty. Our worldview is a mirror that reflects our own image of reality back to us, in a sense, in the ways in which what we believe about reality can have powerful effects upon how we experience reality to be. And very often, the modernists will say, we just want our view of the world to be informed by experience. You know, what's the scientific data and the evidence and so on? And yes, of course, that's very important. But the postmodernists do have a point in that we all view things from our own viewpoint. We do all have to be aware that the way we think reality is can have huge effects upon how we even experience reality. You may have seen some of those videos of psychology experiments where people are given a task involving counting how many times the team of people wearing white t-shirts passes a ball amongst themselves. And they're told, try not to get distracted by the people in the black t-shirts who are also passing a ball amongst themselves. This is about, can you focus your attention, give me the right number of passes between the people in the white t-shirts? And they show them the video and get the results. Now, was it 16, was it 17, was it 18, whatever? Did anybody notice anything odd? No, what do you mean? Well, let's look at the video again, but let's not bother counting. And they play the video again, and only on the second time watching it through do you notice the guy in the gorilla suit who walks into the room, beats his chest, I'm sure you can find this on YouTube, walks out again, because you were so focused on only things in white are relevant. You told your brain, screen out anything black, so you didn't see the guy in the gorilla suit. So just asking someone to do a task like that can put in mind a belief about reality that renders a 6-foot tall guy in a gorilla suit invisible to them. But of course, knowing this kind of thing, we can try and take appropriate measures to lessen those effects, to be aware of our own biases, and so on. We don't need that insight to lead us into the deep skepticism and relativism of the postmodernist. So whether or not our worldview in the end ends up reflecting reality to us depends upon whether or not our worldview is true. Worldviews can be more or less true or false. And being true, just to be clear, being true is a matter of telling it like it is. Being true to the facts of the matter, to things that don't depend upon us. It's up to us what we believe and think, to some degree, but it's not up to us whether our beliefs are true or false. That depends upon how things really are. So a worldview, it functions at this level of a spirituality. Let me expand upon worldview from there to the notion of a spirituality. And say a spirituality aims to be, at least, a virtuous and integrative way of living, a way of relating to reality in various dimensions, via your worldview assumptions and beliefs in your mind about what's true and false, combined with the attitudes of your heart, your affective responses to things, your commitments to things, your choosing and willing, and the combination of what you believe and assume about reality and your heart response will lead you to act. So your assumptions, attitude, actions, or your head, your heart, and your hands, if you like. See, I come from a Baptist background. Sermons have 3 points all beginning with the same letter. Head, heart, and hands. And that is your spirituality. And it becomes a self-reinforcing feedback loop in your life and in people's lives. Because I believe certain things about God and I have certain attitudes positively towards God, that leads me to behave in certain ways, like turning up to Bible study and praying and going to church and so on. But because I engage in those activities, because I do those things, that tends to reinforce my beliefs and my attitudes. Going through having communion is a powerful liturgical reinforcement of my attitudes and belief towards God. So you see, this becomes a sort of rolling a snowball downhill kind of effect, ideally. And that's why it's so difficult to do evangelism and apologetics. When we're evangelizing people, we're not simply saying, oh, could you change your mind about a piece of general knowledge? Like, oh, I didn't think there was a God, and I didn't think Jesus was God, but now I'll adopt those beliefs. Thanks very much. I've cleared up that issue, and I've increased the number of truths in my brain. That's obviously not the full extent of what's going on. Yes, that is going on, but it's your whole person, your head and your heart and your hands, your how you're relating to reality, the way that you feel at home or not in reality is at stake in these conversations and debates between spiritualities and worldviews. And that's why it takes time and patience and love and arguments and so on. Now, I'm not just coming up with this off the top of my head, nor am I the first to think of it. I did note that in his response to the question about the greatest commandment, in the Synoptics, where Jesus refers back to Deuteronomy 6, Jesus says that basically true virtuous spirituality begins with loving God with all of your heart, your attitudes, and with all of your mind, your worldview, and what you think and how you think and so on, and with all of your strength, well, basically your actions, what you do because of that. And indeed, back to Deuteronomy, different verse in Deuteronomy, Deuteronomy 31:12, talking about teaching, assemble the people, men, women, and children, everyone is to learn, and the foreigners residing in your towns, so they can listen and learn to fear or respect, perhaps you could translate that, the Lord your God, and follow carefully all the words of his law. So you learn in your head, you fear, you respect with your heart, and that leads you to follow in your actions, you see? Once you have this kind of grid in mind, you see it popping out all over the place throughout Scripture. And I think that's just because this is how we're made in the image of God to function. And you'll see, you know, you can read New Age or secular books on spirituality that will basically use the same kind of schema. If you know anything about cognitive behavioral therapy, for example, you will see a clear resonance between this kind of structure of understanding of human psychology and motivation and the categories that are used in cognitive behavioral therapy. So we've thought about worldview as then the basis of your spirituality, and we've thought about how spirituality becomes like rolling a snowball downhill. So that's then leads us into the notion of spiritual development. Because I said that spirituality at least aims to be a virtuous and integrative way of life, a way of living that brings wholeness or shalom to the person rather than being disintegrative and and leaving you to be at war with yourself in the world, as it were. So one hopes ideally that one's spirituality leads to, if you internalize that spirituality, not just going along with the crowd, if you own it for yourself, you internalize it, it should lead to a virtuous circle and cycle of integration, of greater and greater wholeness to the person. And of course, as Christians, wholeness in reflecting the person, nature of Christ, as we, you know, the Bible talks about putting on Christ, dressing up more and more like him, as it were, in analogical terms. But of course, spiritualities can lead to spiritual devolution, and one would expect this of false spiritualities. That internalization of a false spirituality would lead to disintegration and a lack of personal wholeness. So as Augustine again said, my sin was this, that I looked for pleasure, beauty, and truth, not in him, but in myself and his other creatures. And this search led me instead to pain and confusion and error. And he famously, at the beginning of his autobiography, The Confessions, very early in The Confessions, uses this famous phrase about God made us for himself. You made us for yourself, and our hearts are restless until they rest in thee. So you see there, true spirituality bringing wholeness and integration, but false spirituality leading to disintegration and confusion and pain and error, says Augustine. Now, we're gradually building up on the categories here. So one more, and then we'll stop for a bit of a discussion and any questions of clarification and so on. I would say that a culture is a shared spirituality. Spirituality is not always individualistic. They can be social. They can be group things. A shared spirituality together with its characteristic artistic traditions. The worldview, that beliefs and attitudes and actions, and part of those actions will be creating things in your environmental circumstances. So they'll be affected by your available resources, for example. If you want to build a building, you know, do you have stone available or not? Will make a big influence on what kind of buildings you make. But so will your beliefs about society, culture, politics, and so on. Like spiritualities, therefore, because they're tied to spiritualities, cultures can be more or less integrative or disintegrative. Now, I would believe and argue that Christian culture, a genuinely Christian culture, will be integrative, and non-Christian cultures ultimately disintegrative. I think the modernist rejection of God is profoundly disintegrative, in that the more consistently one tries to live, or the more consistent one tries to be, theoretically, with the rejection of God, the deeper one is pushed into postmodernism. And this is the link. So within Christian premodernism, the foundation, everything stems from the belief in God and the kind of God that he is. Modernism gets rid of that belief in God, but as we'll see, wants to hold on to a lot of the things that within the Christian worldview actually depend upon God. But they want to hold on to those things. The postmodernists have quite rightly pointed out that that's not consistent, that you can't get rid of the foundation and keep the upper story, to put it in Francis Schaeffer terms. You're just making an unjustified leap. But the key thing is that instead of going back to, well, we better bring God back in, the postmodernists have said, so we better get rid of the upper story as well. And then we're more consistent, in a sense. And I would say, yes, you are. but you've gone off in the wrong direction. You need to bring back in God, and then you can consistently have the things that the modernists, I think, quite rightly want, but don't have a proper foundation for. And that's the sort of, if there's one argument that I'm making in the overall seminar today, that is what I'm trying to illustrate as we understand the shifts in culture and how that plays out from the philosophical level to the artistic level. So, once upon a time, beautiful, beautiful choral Christian music that speaks something about the beauty of God, the harmony of his creation, of the human voices made in his image, combining together to create beauty for his glory, and so on. And here, of course, Leonardo da Vinci's famous painting of the Last Supper, with all its glories of different expressions and the sort of 3D nature, the structure of all the sight lines converge on the face of Christ. This is a painting that says Jesus is the center. Jesus is really important. It reflects a Christian pre-modern worldview. Who is the fairest one of all? Let's take that as a central spiritual question. Well, once upon a time, we looked into the pre-modern worldview mirror, and we asked, who is the fairest of them all? And our pre-modern mirror said, God is the fairest of them all. God is the maximally beautiful being who created the cosmos. I use the word advisedly, not universe, cosmos. And from the Greek, it means ordered beauty. That's why the word is used for Cosmopolitan magazine, a beauty magazine. Oh, how the word has fallen. But, you know, originally, the cosmos is made by God. And that God made humanity in his image, only a little lower than the angels. Wow. Well, here is Richard E. Grant, English thespian, in the film Withnail and I, in a scene where he is obviously feeling rather depressed, as you will see, and he quotes a famous speech from the play Hamlet by William Shakespeare, a speech that I think gives a wonderfully balanced summary of the Christian view of human nature. So the delicious irony of the circumstance in which he quotes that speech from Hamlet about what a thing is man, you know, how noble, how in his rational aspects, how like an angel or a god, and so on. And yet, he's also reflecting his deep depression, his disconsolation with the human condition. Man delights me, nor woman neither. And he's there in the rain, drinking his sorrows away. You know, that is, I think, a very biblical reflection of human nature. We are great and wonderful, and only a little lower than the angels, and yet we are fallen and disintegrating in our sins. And we are both. And we have this very balanced view of human nature. Okay, so we're beginning to get a sense for the Christian worldview. Now, I know, of course, we're Christians in this room, and we think, I already have a sense of the Christian worldview. I live in it. But I think it's good to lay these foundations and explicitly sort of remind ourselves a little at the beginning, because it then makes the contrast as we move through all the more impactful. So I was talking about architecture earlier. This is a building I love from England, Salisbury Cathedral. Very famous cathedral in England. It's got the tallest spire of a cathedral in Europe, I believe, is at Salisbury. And the first time I visited Salisbury Cathedral, I remember on a school trip, drawing up in the car park in front of the main entrance here and looking at the building and being really impressed by just how big this medieval building was. And then I noticed the size of a person next to it, and I kind of doubled how impressed I was, because I sort of looked at the door and sort of go, hey, that's big. And then I noticed how little a tiny person was next to the door, and I thought, hey, that is seriously impressive. They put a lot of effort into this. And if a culture is going to put that much effort into something, it's got to speak volumes about what is important in that culture. And look at our culture today and the things that we put massive effort into building, particle accelerators and shopping centers. Okay, this is Gothic cathedral, a Gothic cathedral. Actually, this is the font. It's newly installed just a couple of years ago font. And it's there in the abbey, and you see it's in a cross form. And actually, water is always flowing into the font and flowing out of the four corners of the font. So it's like the spring of life. And it's there gurgling away at the back of the cathedral. It's lovely. Gothic cathedrals are some of the crowning achievements of Western architecture. They are more like giant sculptures than just buildings, says Levin. Every archway, every decoration has meaning and purpose. Here's a view from the choir stools. You notice you have a choir stool on the left and one on the right, so you can have stereo sound. This is cutting-edge technology, media technology, being used by the church in its day. You know, stereo sound. Look at this. We've got full-color display units installed here. They're called stained glass windows. But we're using the cutting edge of technology of the day to do everything that we can to communicate and speak of God and the gospel. Dr. Emmanuel Paparella, if I've pronounced that correctly, notes that it was the monk's commitment to reading and writing and education which ensured the survival of Western civilization after the fall of the Roman Empire. They laid the foundations for European universities. The universities came out of the cathedral system and became the bridge between antiquity and modernity. This is in the cloister of Salisbury Cathedral, and you can walk through this corridor that goes all the way round the four sides of this sort of Edenic garden that they have there. The Indian Christian thinker Vishal Mangalwadi says that the scientific perspective flowered in Europe as an outworking of medieval biblical theology nurtured by the church. The Bible created and underpinned the scientific outlook, and that's from his book, The Book That Made Your World. And that makes fascinating reading as a Westerner, reading a book written by an Indian philosopher talking about the effect of the Bible on Western culture. And he picks up on this, you know, is why didn't science flower in India? I mean, it's not that Indians are less clever than Westerners. He says it's something to do with the culture, i.e. the worldview ideas that are or are not conducive to the scientific process. And here's an example of this from Salisbury Cathedral. Salisbury Cathedral are the proud owners of what is claimed to be the oldest working clock in the world, dated to around 1386, 14th century mechanical clock. So there again, the church involved in supporting and using cutting-edge technology. Well, here's a charming medieval illustration of God with Adam and Eve in the Garden of Eden, just to illustrate the fact that if you think that there's a rational, personal, creative God who has created the cosmos and who has created human beings in his image as rational, free, creative beings, albeit finite, well then one might well expect those human beings, A, to understand something of the nature of God, not to comprehend God, but to be able to understand something of God, and indeed to be able to understand something of the cosmos that that God has made. Because, as it were, the way in which our minds are designed to work, and the way that the world works, both derive from one and the same rational, reliable, personal, creative source. And so you'd expect there to be a fit at this level of us being able to understand the natural world because of the theological concepts. You expect to be able to do the scientific project. As Alvin Plantinga, American Christian philosopher, says, modern science arose within the bosom of Christian theism. It's a shining example of the powers of reason which God has created in us, a spectacular display of the image of God in us human beings. So Christians should be committed to taking science and the deliverances of contemporary science with the utmost seriousness. Of course, Plantinga will then very forcefully argue that you need to pay attention to some of the philosophical worldview beliefs that can affect how people do science. Particularly belief that there's no God, miracles can't happen. We should not even consider allowing supernatural explanations for things that happen in the world and so on. And he cautioned against that. But the basic point that science actually flowered from Christian theological roots, and so Christians should be seriously engaged in the scientific project. And here we have a photo of the inside of the cloister at Salisbury Cathedral. Leonardo da Vinci's painting of John the Baptist. Now, in one sense, this is a very straightforward pictorial representation. Very programmatic art. But actually, I think this is very abstract, in a sense, as well. Because if you just look at the painting and you don't have a title, what do you see? You see a young man, woman, it's a bit difficult to tell, a young person, illuminated with some golden light from above, pointing up. So what is this? And you get the title, John the Baptist. And they go, ah, I know what you're saying, Leonardo. You are saying this is someone who was illuminated by the divine light, whose task was to point us to the divine light, the light of the world, He is being illuminated by, who is the light of the world? Oh, it's Jesus. Because of the context of the culture and so on, he can communicate those ideas. Those are all communicated. It's not just because we don't literally see what Leonardo is telling us in the painting. The painting communicates at an abstract ideological kind of level because of what we see in the painting, you see. So art is more subtle than the sort of naive idea that some people can get, that, oh, if it's a painting of the Virgin and Child, well, then it's Christian, and you know, if it's just a painting of some guy with some light shining on him, well, then that must be non-Christian. You know, clearly this is a Christian work of art. You know, it comes out of Leonardo's spirituality. So culture at this stage assumed and pointed to the existence of objective, transcendental values by which you can measure all sorts of things in different areas of study, values of truth and goodness and beauty as objective. And if you want to pursue the idea of beauty being objective, which is the strangest thing to say in our culture, even within some church circles, there's a whole chapter of that in my book, A Faithful Guide to Philosophy. I think the church has done an excellent job in modern times of holding on to the concept of truth when it's being denied by postmodernists and so on, and holding on to the idea of objective goodness, because, you know, we need the idea of sin in our theology. Nothing to be saved from if there is no sin. So we've held on to truth and goodness, but we have done a much worse job in the Western church of holding on to beauty and its place in the theology and liturgy. Still, this is the pre-modern Christian worldview. So, here's where we make a transition. We've laid the foundations of our thinking, we've looked at what it feels like to inhabit the Christian worldview and some of the key elements of that expressing itself in various works of art from around the world. And then one day, culture turned its back on God and looked into the modernist worldview mirror, if you like, and asked this question, who is the fairest of them all? And here's a more modern take on the mirror scene coming up in a moment. And the modernist mirror said something like this. According to science, which is the only way to know anything, man is the fairest of them all. Remember, this is back in the Enlightenment, so man is the fairest of them all. Although an unverifiable term, value term like fair, is of course merely an expression of your emotion, subjectively speaking, man is the most rational being to have arisen via the blind watchmaker of neo-Darwinian evolution. Man is a child of Mother Nature who will soon come of age and reject those childish religious superstitions of man's cradlehood. Says something like this. You all know the story. This is the official story of our modern culture. Atheist Michael Ruse, in his recent book, Atheism, What Everyone Needs to Know, says, if you become a non-believer, then you have left the security of your childhood. Typical Enlightenment imagery. There is no ultimate meaning. And secular attempts to find a substitute, whether in philosophy or shopping, simply aren't going to do it. It is gone forever, he says. Or Alex Rosenberg in The Atheist's Guide to Reality gives this sort of creed almost at the beginning of his book. I think this is, from my point of view, I think this is a very honest summary of a materialist worldview. He says, is there a God? No. What is the nature of reality? What physics says it is, full stop. What is the purpose of the universe? There is none. What is the meaning of life? Ditto, i.e. there is none. Why am I here? Just dumb luck. Is there a soul? Are you kidding? Is there free will? Not a chance. What happens when we die? Well, everything pretty much goes on as before, except us. What is the difference between right and wrong, good and bad? There is no moral difference between them. Rosenberg, just to finish up before coffee break, says individual human life is meaningless, without purpose, without ultimate moral value. We need to face the fact that that kind of nihilism is true. You can't create purpose in a world that doesn't have any. That's like trying to build a perpetual motion machine, he says, after you've discovered that nature's ruled them out. And if that seems hard to take, he says, there's always Prozac. And that's not just a throwaway, clever remark, because later on at the end of the book, he comes back to this point and again says, he says, what should we scientistic folks do when overcome by world weariness? Weltschmerz, if I ruined that word, sorry, but world weariness. He says, take two of whatever neuropharmacology prescribes. Because after all, you know, you don't have a mind, you just are your brain, and your brain functions according to its neurochemical, electrical properties. So, you know, if you're depressed, well, you know, take some drugs. Now, of course, it can be good to take some drugs when you're depressed under the guidance of your doctor and so on. I'm not anti-drug taking. I've had depression myself in the past and have found it very useful to take some drugs in combination with having counseling, etc. But for him, that is the be-all and end-all. That is kind of the answer to the sort of existentialist philosophical angst displayed in that sort of angry kinetic music from Muse. And sort of, oh, my place in the world, and we're all doomed and everything. What can I do about this? It's not, well, let's do some philosophy, or turn to religion, or spirituality. It's, well, take some drugs. So you may have noticed that in the modernist worldview, you end up getting this divide, this split in thinking between facts and values. And although at the beginning of this move to sort of get rid of God, you can see a desire for hanging on to morality, human rights, individual dignity, etc. And that is at odds also with the modernist split between facts and values. Now, I think there are facts about values. That's the traditional pre-modern view. But for modernists, in various ways, they end up with a split between these two things. Particularly germane here is the whole idea of scientism that Alex Rosenberg talks about in his book, the idea that science is the only way to know anything reliably, because you soon notice that, of course, science doesn't tell you about values. You know, science will tell me how much poison I need to put in Aunt Mabel's teapot this afternoon in order to inherit her country estate by the end of the week, how much poison will do her in. But science and experimentation is not going to tell me whether that makes me a good or a bad son-in-law or whatever. You know. So scientism is very dominant in Western culture, this view. As Rosenberg says, treating science as our exclusive guide to reality, or at least as our most reliable guide to reality. We trust science as the only way to acquire knowledge, he says. Or Richard Dawkins puts all beliefs into one of two categories. On the one hand, he says there's proper evidence-based belief, and then you have rational beliefs, if and only if those beliefs are based on evidence. And on the other hand, he refers that evidence to ultimately to empirical observation. And on the other hand, he says there's the improper methodology of blind faith. Which he treats as almost one word, as if blind were a sort of redundant qualifier. The new atheists in particular talk about faith as automatically and necessarily a matter of blind faith. He defines faith this way. He says, faith is believing in something when there literally isn't a scrap of evidence. If there were a scrap of evidence, then it wouldn't be faith. It would be proper evidence-based, maybe very weakly based, but at least evidence-based. Or another British new atheist, the chemist Peter Atkins, says, I stand by my claim that the scientific method is the only means of discovering the nature of reality, the only way of acquiring reliable knowledge. So plenty of examples of things that we're rational to believe, but which you can't justify on the basis of evidence. So, you know, Dawkins, one of two categories, this really falls apart. The scientific demand, demand every rational belief in order to count as rational must be justified by evidence, is actually, it's self-contradictory. If you apply that rule to itself, well, it doesn't meet its own expectation. That rule can't be justified by evidence. So it's a self-contradictory philosophical assertion. Another way of looking at this is to think about the fact that that rule, if you held to it, Dawkins' rule, if you held to it, would entail an infinite regress that could never be satisfied. If you say, in order for belief A to be rational, I've got to have some evidence for it that supports it. Belief A, B, evidence that supports belief A. But of course, in order for my belief in the existence of evidence B, and my belief that the existence of evidence B does support A, in order for that belief to be rational, I've got to have some evidence for it, C. But for my belief in C to be rational, I've got to have some evidence for it. What? You could never fulfill that demand for evidence. Now, obviously, there are times and places where a demand for evidence is perfectly legitimate and required. But what this shows is that that kind of belief based upon evidence cannot be the only rational way of knowing things. Indeed, ultimately, that can't be at the foundation of how we know things. There must be other ways of knowing. And as Craig was pointing out when he was using counterexamples like, well, what about moral beliefs? What about aesthetic beliefs? What about just the rational insight that the law of non-contradiction in logic is true and reliable? Or that 2 plus 2 equals 4 or whatever? Some of those things you can't argue for the truth of the laws of logic, because you'd have to assume their truth in order to argue for them, which would be question begging, which is invalid in logic. And yet we just have this rational insight. We just know certain things, that we have to be things that we know and that we can argue from to other things without having to argue for them, because it's literally impossible to argue for everything, you see. And so this scientism that says science is the only way to know anything is ultimately a self-contradictory position that is therefore deeply anti-scientific. It would undermine the entire scientific enterprise if you tried to stick with it. So scientism, far from being justified by science, is actually, when you think about it, contradicted by science and our ability to do science, which, as we saw earlier, of course, comes out of a theological worldview. Any questions about scientism and the fact value distinction that modernism imposes upon us? Oh, good. Okay, one more cultural example in modernism. We started with some architecture. Let's look at some modernist architecture. Le Corbusier, nicknamed the Crow, a French architect. The French architect who coined the famous phrase that houses are, as he called them, machines to live in. This is what a house is. It's a machine to live in. A very modernist, sort of scientific kind of way of looking at things, which you can see is probably based on a very sort of modernist, scientific-only kind of understanding of what people are and how society should be organized and so on. We want, you know, the efficient, organized, scientific society kind of thing. So we all live in our very efficiently stacked, organized, identical, easy to reproduce boxes. But even there, you can see that the longing of the human heart for a little bit of beauty and aesthetic and difference and individuality coming through. Because why are there these little bits of different color on here, painted onto the concrete? It would be much more efficient not to even have that there, to paint it all the same color, wouldn't it? Have it gray. That's nice and efficient, but not very pretty. You see. So houses are machines to live in. for the human machine to live in, and yet there's something about the human machine that seems to long for things that machines shouldn't long for, if that is the be-all and end-all of human nature. I think it's fascinating how the city and how architecture is used in television and film stories and so on, in media, sort of as a character to give an atmosphere to a story. C.S. Lewis talked about the way in which you revisit your favorite stories in order to re-inhabit a certain world or atmosphere, a certain feeling of that world. You don't go back and read Lord of the Rings in order to discover what happens, unless you've got a very bad memory. You know, so you don't reread an Agatha Christie crime novel in order to work out who done it, because you already know on the second time through. But you might nonetheless reread it because you just love those characters and that world and that setting, that atmosphere, that feeling. And architecture and the city is particularly used to give atmosphere and feeling. And in modern culture, here's, I'm going to show you the opening credit scene from the series one of the crime drama, the Bridge, the Swedish-Danish crime drama, The Bridge, in which the filming of the city as a sort of extra character in the story that gives a very kind of ominous feeling to the whole thing. And then you're into the crime drama. But the atmosphere has been set of this, and we did see a windmill and the statue, pre-modern, but everything else is this very sort of at nighttime, sodium light-soaked, concrete, modernist, sparse, industrial, that lone figure that we see smoking against the out-of-focus light, the sort of lonely individual in the heart of the big bad city. The city where you can be a stranger to lots of other people, and as the series goes on, it develops crime stories based upon the idea of various social tensions between different groups with different ideologies within society, who, because they're in a city, are living and rubbing shoulders with people with ideologies that they disagree with, and this leads to the crimes, because we don't have a sort of society in which we all know one another and we're all sort of based on the same worldview or the same ideology or what have you. And the makers, I watched one of the making of documentaries from one of the series, and they talked about the way in which whenever they showed nature in the series, they didn't want it to be beautiful. They wanted to show a kind of nature that humanity has divorced itself from in the city, that is sparse and kind of alienated from humanity. And various cultures within the city are alienated from one another. And it's only the police characters who go from one culture to another, from one social class to another, as they're doing their investigation. And so sort of anxiety about human life in the city is a big sort of literary filmic theme, particularly in crime drama and so on. And this sort of modernist architecture, they're using it there, and our feelings about it, to say something about our unsettled feeling about the way culture and society is going. And I think that's, it's fascinating. Excellent series. Not for the weak of heart, The Bridge, I have to say, but really compelling crime drama that's saying something about contemporary culture. Science fiction, and a whole other category of film, but still, you can see the way in which Ridley Scott, in the opening scene of Blade Runner here, again, sets up the whole sort of mood and feeling of the world that you're going to enter in a futuristic crime drama this time, using this sort of industrial, very modernistic, scientific, kind of view of the city, and again, the anxiety of the city. Perfect marriage of the music from Vangelis there, and the electronica score from Vangelis, and the artistry of the miniature work there. Going to and from seeing the city and seeing it reflected in the eyeball of what turns out to be the main character, Harrison Ford's character in the film. But also this linking of old and new. You've got this sort of pyramid kind of structure where the baddie of the piece lives. And yet this sort of very industrialized advance back to the sort of muse and a lot of this sort of industrial imagery and so on. And the idea of the the lonely individual looking out upon the sort of modernistic scientific culture that is kind of dwarfing the individual as well. And you might think, well, oh yeah, science fiction and so on, but if I show you this picture, the giant LCD screen here, the advertising, the skyscrapers, the polluted atmosphere of the futuristic industrialized city, and this picture of the giant LCD screen in the polluted atmosphere of the skyscraping industrialized future city, and tell you that, of course, this picture is from Blade Runner, and this picture is from Beijing today. Apart from the flying cars, we're already living in that futuristic world that Ridley Scott's film depicts. Final cultural example in modernism before we move on to looking at postmodernism. The musical artist Stuart John Woolley Wolstenholme, 1947 to 2010, did some solo albums later on in his career, including this song called Blood and Bones. And he went round an exhibition, and there's a photo here from the Blood and Bones exhibition that he went round. It was an exhibition of human cadavers that had been preserved and set up in various sort of tableau situations at varying degrees of sort of autopsy, if you like. And it was an exhibition, you know, showing people the workings of the human body, what's sort of inside us. And clearly, going around this exhibition, he was mulling over the modernist sort of scientistic, scientific, materialistic, reductive, kind of thin understanding of what a person is in a worldview that gets rid of God, and so we can't be made in the image of God. We can't be made a little lower than the angels because there are no angels and there is no God and no one who made us. And we are just this product, this unforeseen, unintended product of the material world. Doesn't it follow from that we're just material objects? And going around this exhibition and just seeing like the workings, the biological, mechanical workings of the human body, he begins to reflect upon what is a human being. What does our culture think a human being is, and what do I think a human being is? So, and one day, once upon a time, we looked into the postmodernist worldview mirror and asked, who is the fairest of them all? And the fascinating thing with the new version of Snow White is the way in which the Snow White character takes on a messianic dimension in the story still, even in these modern, postmodern times. That is played up more. Rather than, of course, in the traditional fairy tale, the prince who comes and raises the dead Snow White to life through the kiss of true love, and so on. It is an allegory of Christ saving humanity. The prince of peace coming to raise fallen humanity through his love for them, having them eaten the poisoned apple, you know, etc. So those biblical resonances are there in the traditional folktale, played down in the original Disney version that will include magic and the transcendent but won't talk about religion openly, generally speaking. And yet the messianic dimensions of the Snow White character are increased in the modern telling, which is interesting in and of itself. But this postmodern mirror, mirror on the wall replies something like this, and this includes quite a lot of quotations from postmodernists. Although words only mean whatever they mean to you, I'd say that if I can get my colleagues to let me get away with saying that I'm the fairest of them all, well, then I am the fairest of them all. After all, values are merely subjective concepts programmed into the human animal by the blind watchmaker of evolution, which only cares about what works, doesn't care about truth any more than it cares about goodness or beauty. Beauty is my power. Why should we care about truth? Why should we care about truth? We must keep faith with Darwin. We must keep, it's quite, must keep faith with Darwin and admit that we know that all we can know is the subjective meaning of our own words. In other words, we must admit that we know that we don't know anything, which is deeply self-contradictory. But hey, why pay attention to consistency and truth? Why should I? There's no objective should about it. The postmodernist calls the modernist bluff. French philosopher Jean-François Lyotard characterizes postmodernism as incredulity towards meta-narratives. In other words, being skeptical about big overall stories of reality. If you've got a big overall picture, a frame, an understanding of life, the universe, and everything that you want to share with me, I am going to be deeply skeptical about that, he says. Of course, that is his overarching framework and big picture that we... But, you know, that is his meta-narrative. And postmodernism here, architecture, some postmodern architecture. Look what is going on here. We've got the Greek column, classical, pre-modern Greek column with the lovely capitals there. What is this column doing? It's doing absolutely nothing. It has no purpose. What's it holding up? Well, it's just there. We have all sorts of sort of mishmash. We're using the concrete and glass and steel kind of architecture, but we're referring back to classical stonework for no point or purpose or reason, just because, hey, that's fun, you know? Okay, it's fun, but yeah, it's still saying something.
Out of context,
as you say, yeah. It's like, why? Well, why not? There are columns in the building. It's called the M2 building in Tokyo. In America, this is the Rexner Center for the Performing Arts, and Ravi Zacharias talks about this building. I think it's a wonderful anecdote from Ravi Zacharias that gives us a deep insight to postmodernism. And he says this, postmodernism tells us that there's no such thing as truth, no such thing as meaning, certainty. And I remember leaving Ohio State University, and I was minutes away from beginning my lecture, and my host was driving me past a new building called the Rexner Center for the Performing Arts. And he said, oh, look, you know, this is America's first postmodern building. And I was startled for a moment. I said, what's a postmodern building? And he said, well, the architect said that he designed this building with no design in mind, When the architect was asked why, he said, well, if life itself is capricious, it's random and meaningless, why should our buildings have any design or any meaning? So he has pillars that have no purpose. He has stairways that go nowhere. He has a senseless building built and somebody has paid for it. Well, I said, yeah. So his argument was that if life has no purpose and design, why should the building have any design? He said, that's correct. And I said, did he do the same with the foundation? You see, that calls the bluff of the postmodernist meta-narrative. Calls the architect's bluff on this. That actually, when it comes to the foundation of the building, he, of course, is deeply modernist or scientific, or, and that of course fits with pre-modernism as well. He pays attention to, well, actually this doesn't need to stand up and not kill people, and therefore I need to follow the rules of physics and engineering in order to construct this, but then I pretend that I'm not doing that in the rest of the building. There was a silence. You see, you and I can fool with the infrastructure as much as we would like, says Zacharias, but we dare not fool with the foundation because it will call our bluff in a hurry. Think about foundation in worldview terms as well. We've been seeing working through the ramifications of denying God and what happens to the building of our life and our culture and our society when we do that. Can you keep leaping into the upper story as the early modernists wanted to? We've seen later modernists are denying all of those things. And postmodernists are saying, well, if you're going to deny all of those things, how come you're still trying to hold on to science and truth and in society and so on? You're not being consistent in your capricious view of things, only when it suits you. But of course, here we see that that's true for the postmodernist as well. That they also contradict themselves, saying there are no meta-narratives, and that is, they're saying it's a meaningless building, and they don't treat the foundation that way. It's one thing to sit in a literary lecture in literature department at the university, and for the literary professor to say, texts have no inherent meaning. Words mean what they mean to you. It's another thing for them to not bother checking the instructions on the medicine bottle and to take the right dosage when they're given some medicine by the doctor. They don't say, oh, well, this text means whatever it means to me, so I think I'll take 5 tablets, because that might kill them. William Lane Craig says, nobody reads the instructions on medicine as a postmodern literary theorist. The idea that we live in a postmodern culture, though, says Craig, is a myth. A postmodern culture is an impossibility. It would be utterly unlivable. Well, yes. And he also notes that people are not relativistic when it comes to matters of science, engineering, technology. They're relativistic in matters of religion, ethics, the transcendent values, so on. But of course, that's not postmodernism, in a sense, that is modernism. We saw that modernism led to this fact-value divide, was part and parcel of the modernist view. Old line verificationism. Now, I didn't talk about verificationism. I skipped over that little section there. But this was the view that just preceded scientism in culture in about the 1920s and 30s, in particularly, British analytical philosophy in Oxford, was dominated by thinking about what does language mean? When does language mean things? And particularly a guy called A.J. Ayer published a book called Language, Truth, and Logic in his early days, which argued that language is only meaningful if it's true by definition, or in a sort of Richard Dawkins sense, you can test it empirically. So if I say the moon is made of cheese, that's silly, but it's meaningful. And it's meaningful because if I found myself on the moon with a spoon, I know what experiment to do to test it. If I say 2 + 2 = 4, or there are no square circles, or no bachelor is married, then that's meaningful, because those things are all just true by definition. But AJS said, if I say torturing small children for fun is wrong, or that rainbow is beautiful, or there is a God, or there isn't a God, I'm talking nonsense. I've not said something that's true or false. I've just not really said anything. I've just gone... Because those are statements that aren't true or false by definition, he said, and they're not statements that you can test empirically, he held. Now, this movement didn't last all that long, and AJR himself in later days said it was full of mistakes and he gave up on it, principally because it was soon noticed that it was a self-contradictory position. Because the claim, language only means things if it's true by definition or empirically checkable, is not itself a claim that is true by definition or which is empirically checkable. So again, if you apply the test to itself, it ends up saying that this viewpoint is meaningless. So why take notice of it? But you see, if you've had that view of definition or empirical scientific checking tells us when language is meaningful, we say, okay, that doesn't work. What the scientistic view did was say, well, let's take that and apply it not to the meaning of our language, but to when we can rationally claim that we're making true claims with our language. And then you're into scientism. It's true if it's true by definition, of course, or it's true if you can empirically justify what you're saying. Back to what Richard Dawkins said, you see. And that's, it's too narrow, and again, it's self-contradictory. But that's not surprising, given its roots in this verificationism theory. So Craig argues, we live in a culture that remains deeply modernist, however much we might want to use the term postmodern for some sort of aspects of that culture. But those who are pushing the postmodernism, they're trying to be more consistent in their denial of God, as I would see it, but of course they can't succeed because, well, you can't have a consistent view that doesn't have God at the foundation of it, really, ultimately. Because we are human persons and we're trying to think about what's true and we think we ought to pursue the truth. And you ought to listen to me when I try and convince you that my view, be it modernist or postmodernist or whatever, is true. But if I as a postmodernist say, why care about truth? I as a premodernist can say, well, I do, but you don't, so I'm not listening. What are you going to do about it? Let me lovingly put your nose to the grindstone here and say, actually, you're not being as consistent as you think you are. You're hoisted by your own petard just as much as the modernist is as well. Now, J.P. Morland, of course, colleague of Craig's, we've written books together, he published an article saying he thought there were different degrees of postmodernism. He distinguishes four grades, if you like, of postmodernism. And we can divide this into what we might call shallow postmodernism, which is really modernism, as Craig points out, but also deep postmodernism. And you can't, as Craig said, deep postmodernism, you can't consistently live as if this were true, but people do claim that that is true. They do claim that they live like this. So at a shallow level, we have a value-denying. Axiology is the area of philosophy that considers value. So both ethics and aesthetics would be axiology, value-denying. That sort of scientistic or verificationist-type modernism. That's shallow postmodernism. Then as we sink further into the mire, as it were, we would get to knowledge-denying postmodernism. Epistemology is the area of philosophy that considers what is knowledge and how do we know things. If we deny that we know things, we get deeper into postmodernism. So we don't know. Sink deeper. He uses the word alethic because the Greek alethos is to do with truth. Aletic, truth-denying. It's one thing to say I don't know what the truth is. It's an even deeper form of skepticism to say there is no such thing as truth. to be known. It's not just that we don't know it, or that it is unknowable in principle. There is no such thing as truth to be known. See, that's even deeper form of skepticism and nihilism. And at the real depth of deep, deep nihilistic postmodernism, there is this reality-denying postmodernism. Not only is there no truth, but there is no reality. There is really nothing. Ontic, ontos, being in the Greek. Ontology is the study of being. So these are progressively deeper forms of denial of reality. We can't, there is no, we can't know about values, or there are no values. But not only are there no values, we don't have any knowledge about anything. Not only do we not have any knowledge about anything, but there are no truths to be known about anything. Not only are there no truths to be known about anything, but there isn't anything. That would be, but of course, who's claiming that? You have to, as you know, Descartes, I think, therefore I am. Descartes didn't get there first. I think it was Augustine who said, if I err, I exist. In order to be wrong about something, there has to be a me who's wrong about it, surely. So there are some things that I can't be wrong about. I can't be wrong that there's a me who sometimes gets things wrong. So although a pre-modern balanced view of humanity says we are fallen and finite and we don't know everything and we get stuff wrong, but also says, but it is self-contradictory to go to the lengths of saying, but we can't know. We can't get anything right ever. It says, we know, but now we know in part. Oh, do you remember that from St. Paul? We know, but it is like seeing in a glass, in a mirror, darkly, an old-fashioned mirror that's not particularly burnished, not particularly flat, gives a bit of a distorted reflection. But we're still seeing things in it that are real things. So Doug Gruthaus says, postmodernism is so often presented as a radical departure from modernism. But it's easy to miss the insight that postmodernism is in many ways, I love this phrase, modernism gone to seed. It's modernism carried to its logical conclusion and therefore its inevitable demise. Its logical conclusion is its inevitable demise. It is to adopt a sort of Nietzschean nihilism. He said, nihilism represents the ultimate logical conclusion of our great values and ideals. Back in the 19th century. So postmodernism is not really new, is it? It's not new. It's been a current there of the post-Enlightenment denial of God culture. He talks about the great recent event that God is dead, says Nietzsche. That the Christian God has become unbelievable, beginning to cast its first shadows over Europe, he said. For those whose eyes are open, suspicion in whose eyes is strong. He talks about the loss of something ancient and profound, the sun having set, trust having turned to doubt. If you want a one-phrase summary of postmodernism, trust turned to doubt, Friedrich Nietzsche, it's probably as good as you could get, I think. How much must collapse now that this faith in God has been undermined? For example, the whole of our European morality. He's saying, no, if we're getting rid of God, we're going to get rid of a whole lot of other stuff that went with God. And he wrote criticizing English moralistic philosophers who were talking about morals, even though they didn't believe in God. He said, you can't do that, guys. He denied value as well. He said, when one gives up the Christian faith, one pulls the right to Christian morality out from under one's feet. Here's William Lane Craig reading the famous parable of the madman from Zarathustra by Nietzsche. Nietzsche denied truth. It was Nietzsche who said, "Why should you pay attention to truth?" "What is truth?" asked Nietzsche. "A movable host of metaphors." It's just, we're just locked within our how we're using language. We're not really referring accurately to things or not accurately to things, the reality of which determines the truth or falsity of our language. We just have our language. That's so postmodern. What is truth? A movable host of metaphors. Truths, he says, are illusions, which have we have forgotten our illusions. They are metaphors that have become worn out. Wonderfully phrased, evocative, powerfully put, so prophetic. Nietzsche even said this. He said, "I fear that we will never get rid ourselves of God so long as we still believe in grammar." Oh, you could pursue those thoughts philosophically, but we don't have the time. "So long as we still believe in grammar, we can't rid ourselves of God." Atheist Patricia Churchland says that she's a philosopher of mind. She says the principal chore of the nervous system is to get the body parts where they should be in order that the organism may survive. Truth, she says, whatever that is, definitely takes the hindmost. This is a modern materialist philosopher of mind describing the human person, our understanding of where people have come from. But what does that mean for our concept of truth? And yet she's saying that this description is true, isn't she? She's saying this is the truth about humans, that we're here as a result of the process that doesn't care about truth, that truth takes the hindmost in this process of why we're here. And yet she thinks she has confidence that she knows the truth. Atheist Richard Rorty, postmodernist, is the idea that one species of organism, unlike all the others, is orientated not just towards its own increased propensity, but towards truth, with a capital T, is as un-Darwinian as the idea that every human being has a built-in moral compass, he says. In Straw Dogs, we get the quote from John Gray, that to think of science as the search for truth is to renew a mystical faith that truth rules the world, that truth is divine. Modern humanism is the faith that through science humankind can know the truth and be set free. But if Darwin's theory of natural selection is true, this is impossible. The human mind serves evolutionary success, not truth. To think otherwise is to resurrect a pre-Darwinian error that humans are different from all other animals. At least a naturalistic interpretation of an evolutionary process actually undermines your confidence that you can know the truth through science. Again, back to seeing the roots of science were in the theological concept of God and his creation of us in his image. And here are atheist philosophers recognizing this today. He says, a rigorously naturalistic account of the human mind entails a much more skeptical view of human knowledge than is commonly acknowledged, says Gray. Or Thomas Nagel, in his recent little book, scandalous little book, and I encourage you to get it and have a look, Mind and Cosmos. This is a well-known American atheist philosopher of mind. And he writes a book called Mind and Cosmos, subtitle, Why the Materialist Neo-Darwinian Conception of Nature is Almost Certainly False. If truth takes the hindmost on naturalism, how can naturalists be confident of the truth of naturalism? And atheist Thomas Nagel says, evolutionary naturalism provides an account of our cognitive capacities that undermines their reliability, and in doing so, undermines itself. It's one thing to see a Christian philosopher like Alvin Plantinga in his updating of the kind of argument C.S. Lewis made in Miracles about thought and naturalism. And Plantinga has updated that in terms of his famous evolutionary anti-naturalism argument. Type it into the YouTube search engine and find some of Plantinga's lectures on this. But here is an atheist philosopher of mind saying the same thing. Dr. Howard Taylor, a Christian writer now, puts it this way. He says, postmodernism uses reason to show that reason itself is invalid. But any system which is arrived at by reason and then uses reason to invalidate reason must be self-refuting. Nevertheless, postmodernism is right in saying that there is no room for reason in the modernist, atheist worldview. This is what undergirds and unites both modernism and postmodernism in its various forms. They are children of the same cradle. They are united by getting God off the scene and to some extent or other working through those consequences, and those work through culturally, and we can see them in the culture. And it affects, it's not just about the ideas that people think in the ivory towers. It works its way through culture and it affects what it is like to be a human being living in a particular society. It leads to, I think we can see, this sort of disintegrative, angsty spirituality rather than an integrative, holistic, shalom-making spirituality. So here's a summation of what I've been arguing, and then we'll have a bit of Q&A and we'll stop in time for the writing out of the forms and getting our coaches and getting to our homes. So here we have a pre-modern worldview in which God is foundational and central. And that worldview has room for science, great, for wisdom as well as reason, for objective purpose and meaning and values, objective goodness and beauty and truth. And these support one another. They cohere together. You can do the science because of the transcendent values, because there's something beyond what the science can tell you. You can do the science. But then along comes modernism. And modernism says, let's draw our circle a bit differently. Let's put a naturalistic worldview at the foundation. Or, I love science, let's keep science. But I want to leave out God. That's out there. Truth, yeah, we need truth because, you know, science, truth. But this goodness, beauty stuff, that's really, let's leave that out. I mean, we can talk about it, but only in subjective, relative kind of terms. We have an axiological, a value-denying postmodernism. But indeed, the modernists often want to keep a sense of meaning of human life and so on. They say, this doesn't need to lead to nihilism and postmodernism and so on. Because I can still be satisfied with my subjective preferences and projects in life. There are things I enjoy doing, so I don't have to get depressed about this lack of objective value stuff. As a sort of existentialist, there's no meaning in life, but let's paint on a smile anyway, kind of. And then along comes the postmodernists calling the modernists bluff and saying, well, this is just shallow postmodernism. It's not consistent enough with your denial of God. It's one thing to have this axiological denial, but doesn't ultimately getting rid of God lead you deeper into denying knowledge? How can you really do science given your naturalistic understanding of what a person is? What about this denial of values? Isn't there some connection between rationality and axiology, between asking the question, why should I value truth? If you say, well, for pragmatic ends, because you happen to want this, that, or the other. Yes, but this, that, and the other are never things within that framework that I should value or pursue. And so if I choose not to, you have no grounds upon which to rationally and coherently object. So we have an aletheic, a truth denying. And if we deny all truth, well, it's one step away from this ontic reality denying. Let's just deny everything. Let's go the whole hog, you know. We've been so inconsistent up to now anyway. But you see, there's a certain rightness to the postmodern critique of modernism. But instead of saying, well, in order to rectify these internal tensions that we've spotted, obviously you need to bring God back in the picture. We need to go back to a pre-modern worldview. That doesn't mean giving up on modern science and so on. But at a worldview level, keeping faith with the traditional wisdom of the Christian worldview that gave birth to science in the first place. But no, actually, we'd be more consistent with the denial of God, and that makes us more and more postmodern, and ultimately, ironically, more and more self-contradictory, more and more disintegrative as a spirituality and as a culture. But at least our culture is now expressing through the arts this dissatisfaction. There are points of contact, to use that phrase, in our culture where we can point to and say, look, it seems to me there's something more than just this life that we're living. Without a soul, I'm nothing more than blood and bones. Okay, well, if that's true, then perhaps I better face up to it. But that is such a significant thing to say that I really ought to be very careful, think long and hard about whether or not that is true. And particularly long and hard about the fact that if I say that it's true that we're nothing more than blood and bones, how does it even make sense to say that a bunch of blood and bones can have true beliefs about things and can rely upon the way the world seems to it? How can you get rationality from non-rationality any more than you can get value from valuelessness? Isn't that really just a sort of variation on a theme of getting something from literally nothing? Or at least from nothing capable of having the wherewithal to give you what you're using in your very act of denying it. So there's a sort of apologetic argument here to be mounted in terms of come back to God, come back to God, and you can have science and truth and consistency and beauty and goodness and shalom and so on. And you can see the expression of the desire for this in the human heart, in the music, in the films of today. So there is a way that you can describe these things at the philosophical level, and you can also communicate them and illustrate them and interest people in them at the artistic level as well.